Hi. I'm John.
I have an original dystopian rock musical that I have spent the last 8 years of my life writing. And rewriting. And rewriting. And in just over a week, I will be 30 years old. And what exactly do I have to show for myself?
Tick, Tick, Boom is quintessentially about what it is to devote one's life to one's art. And how do you build your life around things that you love, people that you love, and work that you love?
Tick, Tick, Boom is a snapshot in time of Jonathan Larson finding his voice.
This is that moment. It's the first time people are gonna see the show that aren't just us.
Well, it's good that you're not putting too much pressure on it or anything.
He's spending his 20s writing this musical that he's been trying to get anyone to be interested in and banging his head against the wall of his childhood dream while his friends grow up. It was like a sneak preview of my 20s saying, hey, Lin, all your friends, they're gonna get real jobs. It's just gonna be you, and the world is gonna tell you no every day of your life.
Yeah, I want to leave a message for Mr. Sondheim, for Joe Papp, for Bernie Gersten, for the artistic director of the Schubert Organization.
Jonathan Larson is the perfect example of the pile and stack of rejection letters. And there were moments where I think he did want to give in, and he didn't want to carry on.
I said an omelet with no yolks.
I'm coming.
Why, you're just a waiter.
And thank God that he decided to step into the fire anyway, because now we are left with so much beauty.
This show, it felt like a message in a bottle from Jonathan Larson saying, this is going to be harder than you think it is, and it's going to be worth it if you love what you do.
Tick, Tick, Boom began as this solo piece that Jonathan wrote and performed himself, but there were many different incarnations of it.
We had the off-Broadway version, but we also had Jonathan's many drafts and the stories he told inside of that. There's Boho Days, which was the rock monologue that he initially wrote, and saying, no one is producing my stuff. I'm gonna do a one-man show. You can't tell me that's too expensive to produce. And he continued to work on that for many years, and it became Tick, Tick, Boom. And then it was adapted into a three-person off-Broadway musical.
So we really went back to those original scripts and began to build the film from there, thinking about how are we going to capture that magic.
We do this part?
When we went to the Library of Congress, we had a number of different drafts to look at, their collection of Jonathan Larson's papers and materials.
We just grabbed everything and we threw it all in the pile and said, what's our movie? And we threw everything up on this board. Now we're creating an original musical, and I think we cut three songs from the off-Broadway version. We put back in two from his rock monologue, along with two no one had heard from Superbia. That gets into the skill set I know how to do, which is craft an evening. Like, what do the songs in this order do to your heart? And then how does the storytelling sort of lead us into those things?
Nice. Cool, nice.
For me, musical theater was always kind of this amazing art form that was written by other people in some other land. And then on my 17th birthday, my girlfriend took me to see Rent. The musical just knocked me out, how fresh it was, how contemporary it was, how moving it was.
I just remember being blown away, and it sounded unlike anything else I'd heard. And I had this feeling of, this show is for my generation. Suddenly, you were seeing people on stage that had never been on a Broadway stage like that before, queer people, people of color.
I think Rent was transformative because it was about acceptance. It was about being passionate and joyful and being different.
It really changed the rules overnight and sort of blew open what you could do in a musical.
At a certain point, rock music and pop music and theater music sort of split off from each other, but Jonathan thought they can be friends again. You know, I can write a rock song that has all the same storytelling abilities as my favorite musical theater. There had been pop musicals before, but Jonathan ended the conversation. He was like, these genres have every right to be here on a Broadway stage. So I think that's the greatest legacy Jonathan leaves us.
Do you know how many Jonathan Larsons there are? One.
He lived in the village, and he wrote about his friends who were dying of this plague that was the AIDS crisis in the 80s and 90s, and it felt very personal. I think that's when I went from someone who admired musicals to having permission to try to write a musical. It told me, you are allowed to tell your stories.
That's so funny.
Jonathan had an acute awareness of the ephemeral nature of being alive.
I'm running out of time!
You are not running out of time.
Jonathan Larson sang about the fear of turning 30, and he never reached 40.
Jonathan passed away the night of the first preview of Rent.
We dedicate this opening night and every performance to our friend Jonathan Larson.
I think my family, we have tried to make sure that we're putting my brother's work in the hands of people who really are passionate about it. And most importantly, is trying to make sure we put it in the hands of good people, not just amazing artists and technicians, but also good people, because that matters to us as well.
I think when you're telling the story about someone who actually lived and breathed on this earth, you have to do it with an extra form of care. Julie gave us something so important at the beginning of this process, and that was trust. Every single time we went to her and said, here's a new draft of the script, here's a version of this song, we're gonna try that, she would say, keep going. And I think that connects so well to the overarching message of this movie. And without her support, I don't think we would have been able to make this movie.
It's been an amazing experience under the most challenging situations that anyone could ever imagine during COVID. And we're so grateful that we've been able to actually finish the film and make it happen.
One of the great opportunities of this film, and this is something that Lin was adamant about from the beginning, is that this was not the story of Jonathan's death. This is the story of his life.
Tick, tick, boom.
The most important piece of putting this movie together was who is going to play Jonathan Larson.
Johnny has no guide. Johnny wants to hide. Can he make his mark if he gives up his spark? Johnny can't decide.
Went and saw a production of Angels in America starring Andrew Garfield. I mean, I was already a fan of his, but there was something about seeing him in that show, and he was such a life force, and he was so intense. I mean, you really couldn't take your eyes off him in this sprawling 6-hour masterpiece that I just sort of thought, Jonathan Larson? Maybe? And then I couldn't get the idea out of my head. I just kind of couldn't shake it.
I have been rehearsing all day. I have been up since 4 this morning. I have been trying to write a song for a week, and I am nowhere.
I was excited and intrigued at the prospect of him in this role. There's an intelligence to Andrew's process and his work. Or the only question was, can he sing?
I said, can you sing? And he said, when are you making the movie? And I said, not for at least a year. And he said, okay, then I can sing.
I did learn to sing for this role. That was one of the great gifts of Lin taking the risk and asking me if I was interested in going on this adventure with him. I'd always wanted to see if I could do that. And my relationship with musical theater just accelerated because of Lin.
Yeah! That's great.
I get to be a student again with the greatest teachers and the most encouraging teachers.
It's me mashing the keys there.
Right.
He had never really sung professionally in any way, which was also kind of amazing because he had no bad habits. He was like this new instrument. We did 3 or 4 readings where I would just get a bunch of actors around Andrew Garfield and we would read through the material. We'd take a week to learn all the songs. So at each one of those, he sings a little more. I think the first one, he only sang Boho Days because it was a cappella. There's no way to be off key. You're just singing. And he sang on Sunday, because it was a group number and he felt comfortable singing in a large group, but he was really scared. And rightfully so, he'd never done this on this scale.
This is the life of bo 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 bo. This is the life of bo 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 bo. This is the life of bo 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 bohemia.
By the last workshop, Andrew is blowing the doors off the place.
Ready?
That evolution was really gradual and amazing to witness.
He brings a unique discipline through his work in the theater. Looking at Jonathan Larson's story and what was required from him in this role to learn how to sing, play piano, dance, and also tell the incredibly complicated and nuanced portrait of an artist who is struggling, I think Andrew understands that because he understands dedication to craft. And so I don't think that there is any other actor that could have brought the amount of depth, the amount of understanding to the role of Jonathan.
I can't do it again, Mike. I can't stomach 5 more years of waiting tables, 5 more years of writing things that no one will ever see, while Broadway just churns out mega musicals with not a hint of even the slightest thing original or, God forbid, something to actually say about the world.
Are you done?
Watching Andrew Garfield portray John, he did such a beautiful, nuanced job and just understood who my brother, you know, was. Getting to watch Andrew in this role, I felt like I was sharing time with my brother.
What I hope the audience take away from this film is to keep Jonathan Larson alive and to keep his music, his work alive, and the values that he was espousing alive. We're only here for a short time, so we better make the most of it.
I make a vow, right here and now, I'm gonna spend my time this way.
I feel like in Tick, Tick, Boom, we've assembled the Avengers of musical theater. And I think the extraordinary thing about everyone who's worked on this movie is that they bring a personal connection to it.
I'm such a big Jonathan Larson fan, so to be a part of his legacy, that's what dreams are made of.
We're making magic, and that's really cool and really beautiful.
It's just the perfect alchemy of people, and couldn't ask for anything better.
Well, it's expensive to make art.
No, baby, it's expensive to make art here.
Alexandra Shipp plays Susan in the film.
Susan is Jonathan Larson's girlfriend, but she is also a modern ballerina, a strong, independent woman who is madly in love with an artist.
Can we just talk for a second? Can we just talk about how amazing you were tonight?
Alex wasn't someone I was familiar with prior to the audition process. What I really was excited about was that she's a real R&B singer, and the spin she put on Come to Your Senses was just unlike anything anyone else was bringing to the table.
I'm so lucky that we got to create that kind of central romantic relationship together. And we got to have all these, you know, incredible dance rehearsals together and get to know each other really intimately and deeply and create kind of a complex, deep, loving, free, playful dynamic.
Can you sight read?
Yeah.
I was aware of Vanessa Hutchins through the High School Musical films. I offered her the role of Caressa, which to me is a really important role because I'm a songwriter and I know how important our muses are. And I knew that Caressa needed to have that relationship with Jonathan.
She works with him, bringing his creations to life. I just get to do a lot of singing, which is really nice.
I feel bad that you feel bad about me, feeling bad about you, feeling bad about what I said about what you said about me, not being able to share a feeling.
That voice. Tender, sensitive, joyful, exuberant voice. I didn't know Vanessa before this, and I was so blown away by her work ethic. Like, she's just like, she's there. Like, she's totally devoted, totally present, and I'm playing catch up.
Where's my rye bread?
Well, I was just a big fan of MJ. I'd been a fan of hers for a while, and so it was a very simple math in my head, which was that, you know, this was a real person she was playing. Jonathan had a friend named Carolyn who worked at the diner with him, who was a wannabe fashion designer. So I was like, all right, who's the most stylish person I know? And that's the call to MJ Rodriguez. But I also knew, she has such incredible theater chops and had that relationship with Jonathan Larson's work from having done Rent. And so I was very happy we were able to make it.
Boo Boo, you need to ask yourself in this moment, are you letting yourself be led by fear or by love?
Robin De Jesus plays Michael, and it's just the most genius piece of casting, and Lin knew even before any audition, and I think he secretly was just like, I just want Robin.
What was so exciting was getting to find the character of Michael with him, because often when you see stage productions of Tick, Tick, Boom, they always cast like a very smooth business suit looking dude. And casting Robin short circuits that. He looks like an artist who puts on a suit and is very good at his job, but is very good because he's incredibly creative and he's bringing this skill set over to this world. And I love that because you instantly see he's just putting on a suit. He's playing pretend when he goes to do his day job.
Half of our friends are dying and the other half are scared to death that they are next. So I'm sorry for getting a nice car, John. I'm sorry for moving into an apartment with central heating. I'm sorry for enjoying my life while I still have time.
It's a joy for me, like, to do something so different than all the other work that I've done before, character-wise, you know what I mean? And to, you know, just get to embody someone so full-bodied.
Hey, whatever happens next, I'm here.
There has to be this real brotherhood, this deep, deep brotherhood. And that's another love story in this film. He's just a beautiful soul, and he fills Michael with that soul.
You're missing a song for the young woman.
Elizabeth.
It's the turning point in the show. Your protagonist is either going to go in this direction or that direction. Someone has to wake him up.
For most people who are interested, involved, and love musical theater, Stephen Sondheim has been the gold standard. There are some wonderfully talented composers and writers over the last 50 years, and then there's Stephen Sondheim. For my brother, he was the ultimate, and Sondheim was everything to my brother. He aspired to work with him, know him, be mentored by him.
I had this role of Steve Sondheim. Who do you get to play a legend? Bradley was so game. He just kind of studied and studied and studied, and he passed with flying colors, and he brought such depth and detail to it. Sondheim encouraged generations of playwrights, and that's the other legacy he leaves us, and we get to honor that too. His voicemail to John, which was a real voicemail, and then a real voicemail that he recorded for us. For the film, and so
that was him. Wow, that's
his
Lynn.
Voice on it, and his rewrite of it. Honestly, I think the original line was, "I have a feeling you have a very bright future." He's like, "I didn't really say that, did I?" I said, "Say whatever you want," and he recorded this voicemail and texted it to me, and we just threw it in the movie. And so I'm just really grateful that we get to honor both those legacies.
Give it up for our band and also for my very, very, very dear friend, Roger, on vocals.
Josh Henry, who's been in every one of my Broadway shows. I was so hungry to put him in this movie and show the world what theater audiences already know about him. And I was very grateful to get the chance to do that.
Why does it take a catastrophe to start a revolution if we're so free?
The really cool thing about this process was this story. It's about healing. Jonathan was aware of how much time he had, you know, to get this message out. You know, there were times when in this film where we didn't know if we were going to see the ending of it. You know, there are so many ways it could have gotten derailed. But for me, it was healing, and it was also a very purposeful moment that made me feel like this is the meaning of my life right now.
This is the first real workshop that this musical has ever had. And now you guys are part of the family, so.
These people are like holistic performers. Being surrounded with people like Vanessa Hudgens and Josh Henry and Robin DeJesus and Alex Shipp, who have these incredibly perfected, trained, raw, open singing voices. I truly feel like one of the luckiest human beings to ever walk the planet.
Great, let's do it.
Working with Lin is what dreams are made of. And to be a part of his directorial debut is just so special.
And play that. Julie O, my producer, who had seen me perform as Jonathan in a City Center production of Tick, Tick, Boom in 2015, and said, I have the rights to Tick, Tick, Boom, and I've never written a reply so fast in my life. And I said, your search for a director is over. I'm the only person who can make this movie.
Let's go ahead to scenes 47 to 52 and get the dress.
One, because I know that score inside and out, and I know Jonathan's life just as a fan and as a songwriter in my own right who has been on that exact journey he's been on.
Lin was the perfect person to work on this show. He was influenced by my brother, and he knows and understands this world intimately. They were facing the same sort of struggles and ups and downs and excitements and feeling of despair. So Lin was the absolute perfect person.
It's pretty autobiographical. Of course, he changed names and he embellished sections of it. But because it is dealing with elements of Jonathan's real life, we go to those places. Jonathan is forever tied with the New York Theater Workshop, which is an incredible off-Broadway theater. And we really wanted to film there. We wanted to film him performing Tick, Tick, Boom in New York Theater Workshop itself. Of course, it's a highly successful and sought-after place, and it was fully booked, and it was unavailable. And so we were making plans to build a recreation of New York Theater Workshop, where Rent premiered. And 2 weeks into filming, the world closed down, and we waited until it was safe to go back to work. And when we did, the New York Theater Workshop was available. And so for that glorious week, there was Andrew Garfield as Jonathan Larson performing Tick, Tick, Boom at the New York Theater Workshop again, where he wrote his masterwork, Rent.
I feel bad that you feel bad about me feeling bad about you feeling bad about what I said, about what you said, about me not being able to share a feeling.
And that entire week was so special to be in that space where so much of John's actual creativity happened. A lot of this begins with the conception of the number, and then we figure out sort of the best way to stage it and pre-visualize it. With Sunday, John only ever sang it as a one-man band. And so I, as the filmmaker, have an opportunity to give Jonathan Larson the chorus he never heard. And so I want to build Jonathan Larson's dream chorus. So I want to put in the people that were special to the shows he loved. But I also want to give him this kind of galaxy brain moment that exists outside of time.
Drinking cinnamon coffee or decaffeinated tea.
I knew I wanted to turn the Moondance Diner into a proscenium.
The Sunday sequence in the Moondance Diner was really Lin's brainchild. He had a very clear image of how he wanted to explode that diner in this kind of wild musical theater, legendary Jonathan Larson imagination moment. It was one of the great days on set because, you know, we get paid to have our dreams come true in those moments.
And then as we were brainstorming, I also thought, we can also turn the Moondance into a marquee. And we could do music and lyrics by Jonathan Larson, which is something he never saw in his lifetime.
Beautiful! Woo! Working with Lin is a dream.
He has this spirit about him that is just childlike, and he's so full of gratitude and wonder and exploration.
He is dancing on set, he is singing to you.
Lin is literally doing stomp on set all the time. He'll like click his heels. He's so happy and he's so excited.
Lin listens and hears and respects. And that feeds you as an artist and what you're there to do and what you're there to bring. You're there to give. You're not there to take.
He infused every single day with so much joy that I think he brought out the best in every single person, from our actors to our crew. He made everyone feel like they were there for a reason and they were special.
I love you all. I cannot wait to see your faces.
And it's just felt like kismet. I mean, it has been the loveliest group of people. And I know it starts at the top with Lin and Steven.
Jonathan Larson's work has meant the world to me and is really so much of the reason that I even do what I do. And so the opportunity to be involved with this film was something that I was just desperate to do.
We knew that Steven was the right person to write this. I tracked him down on Tony night after he had won at 3 a.m. outside of the Carlisle Hotel. He was still holding his brand new trophy and I said, "We really want you to write this movie." And his response was, "I would be lucky to write this movie, are you joking?" And I think that feeling is one that's permeated everyone who has worked on this movie, is that we feel incredibly lucky to have been able to bring this to life.
I felt a tremendous responsibility from the beginning with this story, trying to protect what Jonathan had done. He never stopped believing in the value of what he had to say. He knew that he had something urgent and important to say, and he knew that he could change theater forever. And that's something that I'll always keep with me, is trying to remember, as an artist myself, that persistence and that belief in yourself and a belief in what you have to say and that the world needs to hear it.
So what am I supposed to do now?
You start writing the next one.
I think this film and Jonathan Larson's story is something that will be viscerally experienced by audiences. They'll feel it in their hearts, they'll feel it in their bodies, and I think it'll inspire lots of people to live according to their own hearts, their own dreams.
They only ever let me make one movie. I'm really proud it's Tick, Tick, Boom. It's a story I felt like I knew intimately well from every angle.
This is not one of those biopics where you see the Mozart writing his masterpiece. This is a movie about failure and getting back up. And his masterpiece is ahead of him. And it's hopeful because maybe so is yours.
What are you gonna do now?
I'm gonna start the next one.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the Netflix Film Club channel to get our latest exclusive videos. Plus, hit the bell so you don't miss a single one.